how important sample preparation is. And now we go to the next step as a basic lecture. And Alexander is here for the first time. Thank you very much for coming. And yeah, the stage is yours.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So today I'm going to talk about mass spectrometry in general. And even to approach this big subject, I would like to start from looking, from presenting different views of the role. So for you, working in proteomics, it's easy to imagine that all world is based just on proteomics, and of course, because of dogmas and so on, genomics is also there. And other omics, these are the elements which support the life as we know it. But for me, as an instrumentation builder, there is one even bigger platform. And this is supporting turtle on which all these elephants are standing. And this is the art of instrumentomics, which could be defined as collection of all types of techniques and technologies which are necessary for each of omics to advance. And today we'll talk just about one part of this variety of technologies, which is mass spectrometry. But mass spectrometry is a huge science, unfortunately. And even though it develops very quickly, and it's already entering its second century, so it's pretty mature technology, but there is still a lot to do, as we will see later. So first, let's start from the very basics, so that at least everybody will get at least first slides here. So what is mass spectrometer? We could have a very complicated definition, but generally this is a machine to weigh molecules. And mass spectrometry is used to identify molecules in all types of materials, solids, liquids, gases. It could be used for quantitation, and it could be used for structural analysis of molecules. And if we just approach the simplest concept of mass analysis, then we could start from a mixture of different points, and what we try to do with mass spectrometry is just to sort them out according to their nominals. And as you could see, I borrowed this slide from this State University in US, so these are all American coins, but we will go forward. And this is the variety of objects which are analyzed of mass by mass spectrometry. So we start from hydrogen, shown here. This is usually the domain of elemental mass spectrometry. And then we go to organic mass spectrometry, with most famous representative being, for example, aspirin. And then we finish with large proteins, where again the most famous example is the monoclonal antibody. And this shows the huge scale which needs to be covered by this technique. And important aspect of this analysis is that every element, as was proven once in the, by mass spectrometry, have a lot of different isotopes. And these isotopes have their own characteristic masses. So we have carbon scale, where carbon 12 has exactly 12. And then all other atoms have their own digits. Somewhere like third or fourth digit is different from the nominal mass. And these digits are very important for understanding which molecules, which atoms comprise the molecule. And this is where accurate mass analysis is focused on, just to find all these third and fourth digits after the nominal mass and use them in order to find out elemental composition. And of course, you could already start to see some problems. Some of the isotopes are present at very, very low abundances. And therefore, we need to analyze not only large representatives of this particular molecule, but also very, very low abundant ones. And mass spectrometry as a technique started a long time ago. At the end of the 19th century, Thomson was the first to find out that whatever rays emanating from his first original iron source could be actually split into several different species. And some of them are positive, some of them negatives. Negatives resulted in discovery of electrons, and positives appear to be much more complicated because they could have many species. And so it took many more years until Aston developed a machine which analyzed those positive rays in a more focused fashion. And this is where he was able to establish existence of isotopes, which we saw on the previous table. And this is where mass spectrometry has officially started. So this is why the century of mass spectrometry was celebrated in 2013, to mark this first combination of electric and magnetic field to split positive rays into separate species. And this is where the basic configuration of mass spectrometry was already established. So there is an ion source where molecules are converted into charged species. There is mass analyzer, which separates those species into different objects to be measured, not necessarily specific particles, but something which could be measured. And then different types of detectors to record what actually is being separated in the mass analyzer. And so this basic diagram establishes also the framework for my presentation. So we start from ion sources, and then we go to mass analyzers and detectors, and this is where we basically stop. I wouldn't try to introduce the entire different art of liquid separations, which are of course very necessary for protonics. We have different lectures for this, or I will not go towards actual analysis of all these proteins, because this is another lecture which we will have later during the week. So today we just explore those separate bricks, but each of them is already very complex, and each of them is a separate science on its own. So let's start from ion sources. These are ion sources which we observe in nature. These are just lightnings recorded with time-lapse photography. And these are ion sources which we use for biological mass spectrometry. There is a long history of pursuit towards softer and softer techniques which could analyze or which could convert biological molecule into charged species without breaking it into million pieces. So it started with direct chemical ionization, something like 50 years ago, followed by field ionization in very strong electric fields. There was secondary ion mass spectrometry, desorption by products of californium 252 decay, fast atom bombardment, and so on. And now this is where we are. So these are methods of choice for soft ionization, electron spray, and matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization. And all others by now could be considered niche ionization methods, which are widely used, but not for protonics. So for electron spray, this is one of the first spectrum presented where it already became clear that molecules in solution could be converted into ions, and funny enough, they are multiply charged. So this is spectrum of protein which could take up to tens of charges, usually protons, from the solution, and then those protonated molecules could be transferred from atmosphere into vacuum and then detected. And those who didn't like this method called it filling a bath through a keyhole. But nevertheless, this method took off, and now majority of protonic experiments are done using electron spray. So these are the first spectra, as presented by John Fenn, who got Nobel Prize in 2002 for this work. So these are first indications of the charge state distribution, which could obtain with the electron spray source, and also of the complexity, which needs to be addressed. Approximately simultaneously, matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization was discovered first by Koichi Tanaka and then greatly improved by Karas and Kirin Kampo. So Kaichi started with using metal matrix, and then Karas and Kirin Kampo discovered organic matrices, which were much better to absorb light and transfer protons to the analytes. And again, breakthrough came with the discovery of ionization, possibility of ionization of very heavy proteins. And there you could already see that some of them also could be multiple charged, but generally, preferentially, we get single charged ions in moldy. And again, those who like electric spray and don't like moldy call it mining potatoes with hand grenades, just to show how inefficient the process is. And we all know how great these sources are, but my responsibility is also to show what are those facts which people prefer not to mention, talking about this iron source. So let's call them like dark facts or dark arts of mass spectrometry. So of course, we know a lot about mechanisms of electric spray and moldy, but in reality, none of those mechanisms explains all features observed in experiment. So guesses are really good, but they're definitely not final. And probably they will never be finalized, though they're good enough to work with those sources. And both electric spray and moldy produce not just molecular ions, they also produce a lot of artifacts, which we will consider later. Recently, there is one more method of ionization, which is called inert ionization. Usually, you could associate this with the name of Sarah Trimpen, but actually, rapid evaporative ionization mass spectrometry by Zoltan Tackles and other methods also belong to this method of ionization. And everything points to the fact that this inlet ionization is actually a real process, and it's somewhere located in the gap between electric spray and moldy. So you could get all continuum from single charged ions to multiple charged ions with this inlet ionization, but efficiency of it is much lower than in electric spray. So for electric spray, we have good news that with the latest high-end ion sources, we approach saturation on ion transmission from solution to vacuum of mass spectrometer. So now we could get up to 50% of molecules from solution into vacuum in ionized state. But this is possible only for very low flow nanospray, below 100 nanoliters per minute. As soon as you go above 100 of nanoliters per minute, your transmitted ion current saturates, regardless of how much sample you deliver. So you could deliver up to 1 milliliter per minute, but your current will be probably the same or slightly higher than at 100 nanoliters per minute. And also important for proteomics is that not all peptides are ionized equally. That difference could be an order of magnitude, and this makes absolute quantification much more difficult. So you need internal standards and other tricks. For moldy, we have different elephants in the room. So first, ionization efficiency in moldy is actually pretty low. It's between 10 to minus 5 and 10 to minus 3. So it means that 99.9% of sample is never seen in mass spectrometry and get lost. And also, ionization is extremely dependent on matrix preparation, and this precludes absolute quantification. Though, for qualitative analysis, it is great because of its speed. And these are facts which we need to remember when we design any proteomic experiment. For example, very high efficiency of electric spray ionization forced proteomics to move towards nanoliter sample flows. And then we suffer from all types of dead volumes, irreducibility of retention times, and other issues. But in fact, it was all driven by this desire to get as much as high conversion from molecules to ions as possible. And so, what artifacts could be produced by such ion sources? For example, if you consider electric spray, we take our molecular entity in solution, and then as we spray those molecules, they could appear at different charge states because they have different perturbation state. So they could split into 3 to 10 charge states. Then each of charge states has the entire collection of isotopes. And you remember we have C13 isotope at 1% abundance, but if you have 100 of them, then your maximum of intensity shifts from monoisotopic peak somewhere into the middle. So you have at least 4 to 8 isotopes into which analyte splits. Sometimes it could be up to 10. And then if you look at the bottom of dynamic range, which we take here arbitrarily for 5 orders of magnitude, then for every of those peaks, we also have fragments, because even though electron spray is a very fragile method of ionization, in reality, somewhere deep down, each of those ions have some probability of fragmentation. So each of those guys produce some fragments as well. And then, on top of this, each of those ions could produce cluster with the solvent. Usually we don't see them because they're very, very low abundant, and instruments are built in such a way that we break those clusters away, but we need to find balance between fragmenting and clustering. So by reducing clustering, we induce fragmentation. So somewhere, instrumentation is set up to find certain balance between fragments and clusters, but generally, one molecular entity could result in anything between 60 to 40,000 molecular peaks, ion peaks, within the dynamic range of 5 orders of magnitude. So this fact alone puts a cap on the dynamic range which mass spectrometer could analyze in a sample. And this is something which somehow never gets mentioned, but this is what we find when we try to run traditional data-dependent acquisition. We start triggering on this side, largest charge states, good isotopic distributions, and then we run out of patterns because whatever is left are those fragments and clusters of the large ion species. And now we go to the next brick of our diagram. So this was ion source. Now we go to analyzers and detectors. And here I would like to show you one of the mechanisms which is as complex as our modern mass spectrometers, but this dates back to the 4th century BC, and this is how it looks now. Just a piece of something which you could barely distinguish man-made features. So this is so-called antikythera mechanism by the place where it was found under the sea. But in reality, it's hugely complicated system of wheels which was used to predict location of every planet on the sky 25 centuries ago. And this is how it looks when it is restored using the all types of modern reverse engineering technologies. And so today I'm going to present this type of complexity of mass analyzers with this type of level of detail, so that we don't get drowned in every little part of this mechanism. So generally, we have pretty large zoo of mass analyzers. So we have two classes of mass analyzers. First is beam type, and second is track. In beam class of mass analyzers, or beam kingdom of mass analyzers, we have magnetic sector, which was historically the very first way of separating ions according to their mass to charge ratio. And they work like a prism, disperse ions like prism disperses light. Then we have quadrupole mass analyzers, which surfaced in 1960s, which utilize ion stability or instability in RF fields. Then we have time of flight, where we force ions to race towards the detector. And now we come to the kingdom of trapping mass analyzers. Here we have two large classes. One is radio frequency traps, and another is Fourier transform traps. In radio frequency traps, we have pole traps, which we will see later, linear traps, and Fourier transform, order trap, and ICR. So now we'll go quickly through each of these analyses, because at some point we will face each of them and you will have to make your choices and design experiments knowing the limitations of each of them. So, generally, even though modern mass spectrometer looks a little bit more complicated than it looks 100 years ago, we still see the same three major building blocks: source, analyze, ion detector, but we also have data system, which provides data processing, we have sample production system, but the heart of mass spectrometer is still analyzer. And the analyzer is characterized by a number of key analytical figures of many. So first, of course, is resolving power, but then there is also transmission, which turns into sensitivity, mass accuracy, dynamic range, acquisition speed, quantitation, mass range of detection, and not the last but not the least is simplicity. So starting from resolving power, this is how we define it. This is inverse of relative width of the mass peak at certain level of the peak. And this separates how sharp our mass peaks are. And this sharpness is analog to sharpness in optical images. So here you have the same image taken at different resolutions. And here we have black and white image at low resolution. Here we have colorful image at high resolution. So images are alike, but of course we would like to prefer this one because we could see much more detail and we could choose which of those pills to take or not to take. And now we could see how mass resolution results in the selectivity of analysis. So if you look at two isobaric species mixed at a ratio of 1:3, if you have resolving power like 15,000, we see just one blob, one peak, and we cannot identify any of them. If you go to 35,000, we start to see the small peak separating out. At 50,000, they're already almost completely separated, and their masses are already almost accurate. And at 100,000, they're widely separated, and we could determine elemental composition of each of them just by accurate mass alone. So high resolution allows high selectivity of mass analysis. And this is why it's so important. And for complex mixtures like protonic mixtures, this is the key to avoid false positives. And mass accuracy, as you could see in this old graph, allows to reduce the number of false positives. So it allows to improve confidence of mass analysis. But one important thing is that high mass resolution and high mass accuracy are not the same. They don't always come together. You could have 10 million resolving power on ion trap, for example, but your mass accuracy will be still 0.1 Dalton because there are other effects at play. So mass accuracy is much more complicated feature than mass resolution alone. And so if you go through the zoo of mass analyzers, this is our first historically mass analyzer, magnetic sector instrument, and this is how modern magnetic sectors look like. Complicated ion sources, complicated extraction optics, very advanced laminated magnets with correction lenses, and then we could have multiple collectors, some of them Faraday cups, some of them with electron multipliers, and everywhere they separate according to mass to charge ratio, so different ions, heavier ions, travel on higher radius in magnet, and lighter ions on smaller radius, and then you could focus ions with very high accuracy onto those collectors. And because you measure ion beams continuously, you could achieve precise measurement of isotope ratios, for example. And this is where those instruments are mainly used nowadays. For detector, you could have this Faraday cup, which is basically a black hole for ions. Once they get in, no secondary particle could leave out. And here we measure just current. Or it could be electron multiplier. When ion collides with the surface, emits electrons, and those electrons are sucked into the resistive channel, getting multiplied all the way. So that one ion could result in 1 million electrons on the output. And then those electrons could be detected by normal electrometers. So this electron multiplier is of course a great invention because it allows to detect single ions and convert them into pretty big measurable signal. So now we come to the next mass analyzer, quadrupole. So here, according to its name, it has four rods, and in these four rods we have DC and LF applied to them. And ion motion could be described by Mathieu equation, which we'll see later. And generally, we could separate all areas of DC and LF voltages into combinations which result in stability in one direction, but instability in another opposite direction. So they're stable in this direction, but not this one. And only this area is stability region for all masses in both directions. And we scan DC and LF in such a way that only small portion of the mass range is remaining stable. All others are unstable. And then only this ions which satisfy this condition are transmitted through the quadrupole. All others are lost already on the first centimeters of the path through the quadrupole. Another relative of the quadrupole mass filter is ion trap. It also uses LF fields, and there are three-dimensional traps as originally invented by Paul 60 years ago, and extended versions, two-dimensional versions of such traps, linear traps. And here, in both cases, in both quadrupole and ion traps, we have the same principle of effective potential, which means that we have ions moving in field which is changing in time, let's say sinusoidal. But this field is spatially homogeneous. So here we have axis. So field is weak here and it's stronger here. So ions go half of the time this way, half of the time this way. And if you just base this on our everyday experience, nothing should happen to them because you move them left, right, but in reality, when you move them right, you always move through the stronger field. When you move them left, you always move through the weaker field. So work done by the field is not exactly equal in both cases. So in one half period, it's bigger than in another half period. So when you average, you just add this to this, all of them, you actually get something which is not zero. So even though we have strictly sinusoidal LF field, its spatial inhomogeneity results in average force, which forces ions towards the axis. So it pushes ions towards the minimum of the force, which is the axis of the linear trap or quadrupole. And this is now nice mathematics. So this is actually an equation which describes motion of those ions. And you could have this in two directions. So here for ion trap, there is radial direction, there is axial direction. And then these are areas of stability. And then in order to see to get ions stable in both directions, you need to overlap stability in axial direction with stability in radial direction. You get overlaps. And then when we zoom on this, this is stability diagram for an ion trap. So for quadrupole, we use just this part, this tip. For ion trap, we could also use this tip, or we could stay on the axis where all ions are stable. So this is fundamental principle of operation of all LF devices. They all rely on this averaging of the LF field. And then you could use it in different forms. For example, if you look at how ions are located within this trap, you will see that all low masses are located on the right of this stability diagram. High masses are located at the left part. And they're sitting in a potential well, which is the deepest for those guys and smallest for the larger masses. And this is the reason why ion traps are not really good for heavy masses, because the potential well in which those high masses are sitting is very shallow. and it's sufficient to have even thermal energy to keep them out. For those ions which sit here, potential well is good, it's deep, so they're not getting out very easily. And you could get them out by exciting just these ions by special additional frequency. And this is how all ion traps operate. In quadrupole, you don't allow them to sit all together. You apply DC field, which allows only ions sitting at the tip here to survive. Everything else gets kicked out from the quadrupole. So now we come to the next type of mass analyzer, time of flight. So in time of flight, we have the easiest principle of separation. So we just accelerate ions from a pulse source down a long flight tube, and we could do this, for example, by very short pulse of electric field. And then we give them this potential energy, which converts into kinetic energy, and then we could use these equations to get a formula for link between time of flight and mass to charge ratio of ions. And this is very simple. So time of flight is proportional to square root of mass to charge ratio of ions. So we kick ions out, we allow them to race towards the detector, and heavy masses always arrive later. And light masses, of course, arrive first. So this is the basic formula for any time of flight, but in reality, there was a long evolution of time of flight instruments. So they started back in the days of Manhattan Project, and at that time they worked like an ancient trebuchet or ballista instrument. You just kick ions out and then they fly towards the electron multiplier at the end. And there were some attempts to improve performance of the instrument using spatial focusing by William McLaren, but generally it remained a low resolution instrument which was not able to get anywhere with the mass accuracy and so on, even close to magnetic sectors. And then generation 2 was initiated by invention of an ion reflectron by Makarov, and this allowed ions to fly like a boomerang. So here we get faster ions to penetrate deeper into ion liver, and this means that even though they are going far and far ahead in the field region, then they have to go deeper and deeper into reflector as they turn back. And as a result, light ions or fast ions and slow ions of the same mass arrive simultaneously to the detector. This means that we get time of flight focusing on ion energy. And this allowed not only to improve resolution of the whole instrument, but also to increase strength of extraction fields in the ion source. And this reduced turnaround operations and generally allowed to increase resolving power of instruments from few hundreds to many thousands. Next generation appeared at the end of the 80s, where continuous ion sources entered the stage. And the same instrument was used in a different way. So ions were coming not from a surface, for example, but they're coming orthogonally from external ion source into this accelerator. And this worked as a conveyor. So ions are continuously transferred here into on the conveyor, and then they are chopped into pulses by this pusher here. And another name for this is a spaghetti factory, because you continuously extrude your dowel and then chop it down by this pusher and then detect by this detector. So you combine advantages of ion mirror, high resolution, longer flight length, together with the high duty cycle for continuous ion beam. And then also in the 90s, next generation of those instruments appeared, where orthogonal time of flight was interfaced to tracking device in front here, so that you don't continuously supply your dowel, you supply it only when the instrument is ready to kick it out. And only within the recent couple of years, this orthogonal top, the trapping, entered the stage of practical mass spectrometry. Now, fourth generation, which is heavily discussed and presented at conferences, is folded path time of flight, where there are several classes. There is multi-deflection and multi-diffraction systems. In multi-deflection systems, there are, for example, two planar mirrors, and ions are ejected from the source, again in a pulsed manner, and then they're continuously focused by intermediate lenses, so they never diverge too far, and then they come back to the detector. So here we talk about flight length, not 2 meters like in modern commercial time of flight instruments, but more like 20 or even 40 meters. And these instruments, of course, allow to reduce effects of the source, to increase resolving power, and so on. In multi-deflection instruments, like shown by Gerald, ions are sent on spiral trajectory, so that it's multiple, tightly folded in a limited volume, and then you could get also almost 20 meters flight path, which allows high resolving power, which they use for multi imaging. So now we come to the next class of analyzers, Fourier transform mass spectrometry. Here we have two major representatives of this family. So we have ion cyclotron resonance instruments and orbit traps. So in FTSR, ions are trapped in combination of this electrical field and huge magnetic field of a superconducting magnet. And this magnetic field doesn't allow ions to escape, so once we excite them, they get stay trapped within the magnetic field, and in orbit trap, ions get trapped by the electrical fields, as we will see later. And then in both cases, we use split outer electrodes to detect induced current, and then we get this type of combination of all these sinusoidal signals from each of the ions, and we try to determine those frequencies using inverse Fourier transform. And because we are measuring frequencies, we could get very high precision and accuracy of such measurement. This allows very high resolution, accurate mass measurement, and very high dynamic range of detection, because this is all just conventional analog electronics without any saturation effects and so on. So, if you look in more detail, for example, into Orbitrap analyzer, actually Orbitrap analyzer is a bit more involved than just trap on its own. So it actually combines several elements. So first, it has external pulsed ion source, because ions should enter Orbitrap analyzer as short packets. Then it has electrodynamic squeezing, followed by orbital trapping and image current detection. And it works in the following way. So here we have an RF-only quadrupole, which we just discussed, which is bent like a letter C, and hence the name C-trap. And ions are entering this quadrupole along the axis, and then they lose their energy in collisions with residual gas in this device. After they get stored along the axis of this C-trap, RF is getting ramped down, and DC field is applied across the quadrupole. And ions get accelerated from the trap, fly through lenses, pass deflector, and then they enter the Orbitrap analyzer of the equator. So they enter here as short packets, each packet containing thousands of ions. And then we start to apply increasing field to the central electrode, and ions get closer and closer to the central electrode because the electric field becomes stronger and stronger. So this is like a black hole attracting stars. But unlike black hole, we could control this voltage. So we stop this contraction, and ions stop their death spiral at optimum radius, exactly between two inner and outer electrodes. And then, because we have multiple ions in each packet, with the different rotational speeds and so on, they quickly spread into this ring, which then bounces back and forward along the central electrode. And this spreading into the ring is very important, because one part of the ring is shielded from the other by the central electrode, and this results in high space charge capacity. And as rings are bouncing back and forward, the induced sinusoidal signal on the output of differential amplifier. Multiple ions induce multiple signals, which we deduce using the inverse Fourier transform. And important part, advantage of Fourier transform detection is that modern electronics allows to detect just few elementary charges due to development of analog transistors and so on. And so this is pretty sensitive methods nowadays. Here you could see different types of orbit wraps. So original orbit wrap, like it appeared 10 years ago in LTQ orbit wrap family. And now we have smaller high field and ultra high field orbit wrap, which we have in the modern instruments. So here we have inscribed diameter of 20 millimeters. And Kai Scheffler will show later in the afternoon how they look like in reality. And if you compare different accurate mass techniques which we have in protonics, we could see that actually they share some features. So here we have three major whales of life science mass spectrometry, FTICR, orbit wrap, and TOF-MS. And for example, we could see that orbit wrap is sort of similar to FTICR because ions are trapped in ultra-high vacuum. We use image current detection, FT data processing. Ions have significant kinetic energy during detection, and we need very long mean-free path, many kilometers or sometimes even hundreds of kilometers before collisions with residual gas. But FTICR is different because there the field which traps ions is magnetic. So you need superconducting magnets, but then you could do injection of ions at low energies. You could have MS to the end possibilities, which you don't have in orbit wrap. But also you need to have broadband excitation to get ions from the axis to the radius where you could detect them. And period of oscillations in FTICR is proportional to mass to charge ratio, while in orbit wrap, like in time of flight, it's proportional to the square root of mass to charge ratio. So it means that as you go to very high mass to charge ratios, you need stronger and stronger magnetic fields. For example, in order to get mass to charge like 3,000 analyzed in FTICR at the same resolution and at the same time as in orbit wrap, you need probably 50 Tesla magnet. So if you compare orbit wrap with TOF-MS, in both we have motion in electrostatic fields only. And so potential wells in which ions are moving are mass independent. In both we have injection of ions at high energy. And in both, if fragmentation takes place, we have huge energy spread, which makes this fragment sort of unmanageable. And of course, we have square dependence of mass to charge ratio. But in time of flight, we have detection not by image current, but by secondary electron multiplier. It means that we need very high kinetic energy for efficient conversion of ions into electrons. And on the other hand, we don't need long path, only several meters or few tens of meters are needed for such instrument. And the resolving power of time of flight is approximately constant across the mass range, but dynamic range is proportional to the detection time. So if you have short detection time, fast repetition rate, your dynamic range falls proportionally. In those two instruments, FTICR and orbit wrap, it falls as a square root. So when you go down by order of magnitude in detection time or order of magnitude up in repetition rate, your dynamic range is reducing only slightly, unlike time of flight. So these are differences which are defined by physical basics of each of those analyzers. And we could have a look at the different ways of, for example, tracing certain compound using each of mass spectrometers. So here I have a photo of the St. Louis Arch because this is where the last ASMS conference took place. And this also looks very much like a chromatographic peak. So here we have this, these skyscrapers and so on. And now let's see how each of mass analyzers which follow this arch. So if we look at this picture using quadrupole mass spectrometer, we will have to follow certain predefined mass ranges, and then this is what we will see. We'll see just snapshots of this arch, because this is exactly what we are looking for. Unfortunately, we will not see everything else, all these other buildings, because we just didn't look for them. So we set our protocol just for narrow mass range, corresponding to this particular picture, and then we could extrapolate the shape of this arch very precisely, but not see anything else. So this is not very good for unknowns, and it makes method development also quite difficult. This is why we don't use quadrupoles, for example, for discovery tectonics. Now, if we look at the chromatographic peak eluting from our separation device, for example, as shown here, this is theoretical profile of the peak, and here we consider typical case when we have 10,000 ions coming from the source, and we analyze at the rate of 5 spectra per second, both by orbit ramp and time of flight instrument. And then we try to stay to follow our peak with very high mass accuracy in order to provide high selectivity of analysis. We just want to see our peak of interest and nothing else. And for this, we need to have tight extract time chromatogram window, which here is shown as ±2 ppm. And then, when we start to follow this peak within the mass accuracy of interest, then at these edges, we don't have many ions appearing there. And it means that our mass accuracy and ability to see the peak will be limited by statistics. And here you could see probability of detecting ion by time of flight instrument. For example, at this point, only 30% chance that we will see any peak at all using time of flight. At this point, when we have more ions, we have more like 65% probability of detecting any mass peak at all within this 2 ppm window. And this results in the chromatographic peak shape, which is shown here. In orbit ramp MS, already at that point, we have almost 99% probability of detecting the mass peak. So, and then it becomes basically 100% due to frequency detection of the ion. So it means that this chromatographic peak will be followed almost exactly using the orbit ramp analyzer. And it's important to notice that here we consider the best possible case for time of flight, which is a resolution 50,000 and transmission of 10%. Usually one of those is an order of magnitude lower, and therefore an order of magnitude more ions are required to get the same peak shape. For orbit ramp, on the opposite, we consider the one of the worst possible cases, very moderate resolution of 30,000 and minimum allowed transmission of 30%. And this means that if you use orbit ramp analyzer with such narrow extraction windows, this is what we will see. So we'll see most of the picture except maybe the baseline. And this is what we'll see with the time of flight instrument. And this is why orbit ramp MS, for example, got such high acceptance in every analysis where very complicated mixtures needed to be analyzed with very high sensitivity. And now, just to finish with the orbit ramp mass spectrometry, I wanted to show that there are several directions of improvements which loosely follow three major directions. One is new trap design with a high dynamic range and new manufacturing techniques, detection high harmonics and so on. New possible methods of operation and new signal processing methods. And now we could compare all these different analyzers which are generally used for discovery protonics. So these are four analyzers which are major block forces, and I wouldn't put here quadrupoles and magnetic sectors because they're not able to analyze ions over wide mass range. And we could see that each of those analyzers has its own combination of analytical parameters, like we discussed. Resolving power of FTSR is second to none. It could go into tens of millions. It has very high mass accuracy, reasonable dynamic range, but speed is quite low, transmission is not great, and it's pretty complex. For ion traps, transmission is beautiful, higher than anywhere else. It detects all ions very relatively fast, but mass accuracy is poor and resolving power is not great. And this precludes it from wide use in quantitation, even though it's a very simple instrument. For time of flight, resolving powers are already quite good. Transmission, though, is pretty low, but speed and all ion detection are unsurpassable. And this results in limited quantitation, and they're not so simple anymore. So for water trap, I dare to draw it in this way. And so it started being read in simplicity 10 years ago, but now it becomes more and more affordable, more and more easy to operate, and therefore I hope that this will turn green at some point as well. And of course, as for everywhere, we have a lot of dark facts about our analyzers. So for every analyzer, whatever we imagine, relative accuracy of field definition is actually defining what resolving power you will get. So if you want to have resolving power 1 million, it means that your field needs to be defined with the accuracy of 0.00001%. Otherwise, you will not get this resolution, or you will get artifacts. And then our latest ion sources could provide very high ion currents, which could reach like 10 billion charges per second. But all those wide mass range analyzers, which we had on the previous page, could detect not more than something like 10, maybe 50 million charges per second, either to avoid overload of detector or analyzer. So in reality, we get only 0.1% utilization of the ion beam from the source. And if you try to put all 10 billion charges, probably you will have to clean the instrument almost every day. And then, for all threatened analyzers, we need very tight control of ion populations. Otherwise, space charge effects could be really very complicated. Specifically for FTMS, the higher resolution you want, the smaller should be space charge. The smaller should be signal to noise of those peaks. And any external storage which we need, because these are pulsed analyzers, so if you have continuous source, we need external storage to convert continuous source into pulse source. All of them have non-linear response on space charge again. And in FTMS, we detect not beams, but waveforms, which means that we need specialized processing methods, which sometimes gets forgotten. But this is relatively small issue at the moment. And then for orthogonal acceleration top, we have a big problem that dynamic range falls as fast as acquisition rate increases. We have high discriminations for low mass to charge ratios and even for higher mass to charge ratios. In orthogonal tops, overall transmission is usually 1 to 4%. And recently introduced trap tops raise transmission to 10 to 20%. But then they introduce space charge issues the same as we have in FTMS. So they need to be carefully avoided. And because you trap ions and release, your maximum number of ions is limited now by a detector rather than by the instrument. And if you go to folded path tops of longer and longer path, you have lower and lower repetition rate. So these issues with the maximum number of ions, with the space charge effects, are only aggravated. But technology is being developed, so sooner or later these issues will be overcome. But nevertheless, there is quite a lot of work to do for analyzers. And now we go to the next level of complexity. So this was all simple. This was just separate analyzers. Now we go to some magical creatures. So here we have examples of such magical creatures. They have different sort of capabilities, different utilities. Like, for example, it's quite easy to imagine why Centaur will be stronger than a man and cleverer than a horse alone. So it combines best features of both. It's more difficult for such creatures, or such these ones, but nevertheless, such mythical creatures which combine half man, half animal, could have large advantages, but they also could be a waste of time. So why do we need this first? So we need tandem mass spectrometers, we need this combination of different creatures in order to step up from just analyzing analytes to analyzing their structure. So if you have just spectrum like this, we could get only molecular weight of the molecule, but we want to know what are the parts, what it consists of. And for this, we subject this molecule to fragmentation. So we break it into pieces, and then we detect its fragments. And this needs to be done after fragmentation. So generally, we separate selection of this molecule of interest from fragmentation, from detection of fragments. And it means that we don't need to have the same analyzer both for this and for this. And here you could see the zoo of all different hybrids which are known in the world. And you could see that they have quite different fate. So by that, I marked those hybrids which probably were mentioned in publications but never took off. For example, if you have FTACR as a mass selector and then you use magnetic sector for analysis of fragments, probably it will not fly even 30 years ago. But if you have quadrupole as the first mass selector, then you could use quadrupole for analysis of fragments or time of flight or ion trap or orbit trap, then you have quite a reasonable instrument. And so by green, you could see those configurations which were picked up by vendors, and they are all available commercially in one way or another. So it looks like these are centaurs, and these are all those hybrids which we don't want to deal with. And now we'll go quickly through some of the most important of those hybrids. So first, of course, is the tracking quadrupole mass spectrometry. So it was historically the first, and this is the most widely used tandem mass spectrometer. So here, you could have different modes of operation. So you could select just one precursor out of the entire spectrum, fragment it in the collision cell, and then you could scan through all products, one by one. Or you could have other methods of operation when you look just at a particular fragment, or you look at the particular neutral loss, and these are necessary to compensate for the selective nature of this MS2 instrument. And we will come back to these analyzers later, because they became workhorse for quantitation in mass spectrometry. Another hybrid, again historically, is Kutov. So here we take advantage of the collision cooling provided by the collision cell. So we have ion source, quadrupole mass filter, and then here we fragment ions and also cool them in collision with gas. So what we get here is collimated ion beam, which enters orthogonal time of flight and gets cut into slices, which get then detected by microchannel plates. And over the last years, we have good progress in these instruments. So now they could provide resolution 30 to 60,000, good mass accuracy, MSMS, and they could run pretty fast when they have enough ions. Another hybrid widely used could be seen here. So this is LTQ orbit trap instrument, which combines features of the linear trap, like flexibility, mass to the end, resolution of mass isolation, high transmission, dynamic range, speed of isolation, with features of the orbit trap, like dynamic range of mass accuracy, of detection, resolving power, mass accuracy, and speed of detection. And this, so here you can see the team, which became this instrument polymerase. And this instrument allows to compensate disadvantages of orbit trap or linear trap by combining these two instruments in a single entity. Another hybrid is combining orbit trap with the quadrupole isolation. So here the most important features are dynamic range of isolation provided by quadrupole. It doesn't care how intense your ion current is, it still will do nice isolation with good linearity. And this combined with high mass accuracy and resolving power of the orbit trap instrument. And the idea was to make this instrument simple, as you could see here. So ions are produced by electric spray at atmosphere, and here they're illustrated by a small piglet. So this piglet first flies really wet, like you will be on Thursday, through all this atmospheric vacuum interface. And then here it gets dried up, walks on the edge through what we call mass filter, and gets trapped in the citra. And now you can see the piglet is very anxious because it has to go down into the orbit rod along this slide. But it is brave enough to jump down, and then we listen to its oink oink as it moves inside the orbit rod analyzer. And of course, this instrument became the most successful hybrid MS in the recent history, and therefore it sort of bred itself into all types of different configurations, as you can see here, starting from Little Pony, Executive Plus instrument used for MS only analysis, followed by Co-Executive Focus for heavy lifting, 24x7 environmental labs. These are the instruments for Pentonics, Co-Executive and Co-Executive Plus. This is the workhorse, and this is the racing horse for Pentonics, because it could run up to 20 Hz MSMS and so on. But I will not go into those details, just to show you the whole ladder of possibilities. And this is how orbit trap technology progressed over the last 10 years. So this is performance of LTQ orbit trap instrument like one. And then if you follow these different analytical parameters, you could see that brightness of the source increased by an order of magnitude, sensitivity of orbit trap detection by a factor of 7, speed of orbit trap on SMS by a factor of 8, and resolving power in 1 second by a factor of 5, and so on. So this was sort of trying to fight to defeat Moore's law. These are just different applications of this tandem instrument. And now we come to the next level of complexity. So this was all simple. We had Centaurs and others, but now we should remember that they're still not perfect. They still cannot do every experiment which we could imagine in Pentonics. And therefore, not two, but now three mass analyzers getting combined. And here I added one more column, which is ion mobility, because in some respect this is like poor man's analyzer, but nevertheless it provides additional degree of separation according to collisional cross section, and it has its unique properties, and therefore it's also part of the arsenal of mass spectrometry. And here we could see that it's very difficult to combine two instruments, but two analyzers, but it's even more difficult to combine three. And therefore, you see only two green spots on this diagram. Everything else was attempted in the laboratories, but it was all abandoned and never picked up by commercial vendors, because only these two actually provided sufficient improvement of performance to justify increase of complexity. And so one of them, first of them, historically again, is a combination of ion mobility with Kutov. So here we could see several different layouts of such instruments. First is layout where you have ion mobility first, followed by Kutov. This is what is used by Agilent and their instrument, and what is Vion. So here you could get resolving power of ion mobility up to few tens, and you could separate ions on mobility, and potentially you could synchronize this with separation by quadrupole mass spectrometry, and it has advantages that you could choose particular classes of compounds and so on, at least on paper. But in future, I think this will develop into techniques which allow to parallelize mass separation, as we'll see later. And then, for here you could see a configuration of what is synapt, where quadrupole precedes ion mobility separation. So first you select your mass of interest, then you separate them according to ion mobility, and then you do mass analysis. And here, again, you could use this to select particular classes of analytes and improve your selectivity. Though resolving power is about 20 for this instrument because of limited length. So to me, these are the first triplets, even though the word was invented much later, but these are instruments which combine three analyzers, and therefore they allow more complicated experiments. this is latest Vion instrument at the great detail. And this is how you could separate, for example, multiple charged ions from single charged ions. This is probably the best utility of ion mobility for protonics, that you could get rid of all this background if you have not so good chromatography. If your chromatography is good, then usually this is not so difficult. And now we come to this word, which was coined just 2 years ago, which reflects combination of three real mass analyzers. And this new word is a tribrid, but as we see retrospectively, tribrids were there already before, but now it's sort of official. And here we have the instrument which combines the top-end quadrupole mass filter with hyperbolic rods, high mass isolation, and so on, with ultra-high field orbitrap analyzer, running at up to 500,000 resolution or up to 20 hertz repetition rate, and dual pressure linear ion trap on the back. So these are three real mass analyzers. Each of them are top of the range. But also there are other players to make these three analyzers communicate to each other. So first we have ion routing multiple here, which is multifunction device used for storing ions, cooling, summing different populations of ions, feeding orbit trap or linear trap, and HCD fragmentation. And linear trap itself is also used for multiple purposes, like storing ions, cooling, isolating, detecting, but also for automatic gain control to control ion population for orbit trap, CAD, ETD, and it also could feed HCD for fragmentation. And it also could run at 20, nowadays up to 30 hertz, and could do MS to the end. So this is like symphony orchestra, which has pretty established players, but there are also many new players which are important for effective function of this device. For example, active beam guide for very fast transfer of ions through the interaction optics, or controlled pressure in ion routing multiple for intact protein analysis. But the most important is this easy ETD ion source, which utilizes Townsend discharge for stable anion flux for ETD. And it also could be used for internal calibration for better mass accuracy. And now I would like to show how this tribrid is operated for the simplest symphony, which is general peptide sequencing and low level ADs. And this is the control of this system, dynamic scan management. So first, ions are produced by the electrospray source, stored in ion routing multiple, and from there, they're injected into the orbitrap analyzer. High resolution full mass spectrum is acquired, and candidates for sequencing are selected, as shown here. And now, we fill ion routing multiple again, inject ions into the orbitrap, and we start full mass scan for the next acquisition. Meanwhile, we already know those candidates for selection, so we start from this guy. Quadrupole is switched to select just this mass, feed it into ion routing multiple, and then after it is fed, it's transferred to the linear trap where it gets fragmented and scanned out. While it's getting scanned out here, we have quadrupole idle, so it switches into different mass, for example this one, and we fill ion routing multiple again and wait until trap is free. Once it's free, we get ions there and start to fill ion routing multiple the third precursor, for example this one. And this goes on and on and on until we reach the end of the orbitrap scan. And now we still have 10th population here, so we transfer it into the ion trap. And while it is analyzed in the ion trap, we are feeding ion routing multiple to inject ions into the orbitrap. And this is done again and again. So this is sort of type of operation which allows to utilize all three analyzers to the full and increase the speed of identification, at the same time keeping very high detection limits, very good detection limits due to single ion detection here. And of course there are many, many different applications of this instrument. One of the biggest killer applications is multiplex proteomics with TMT 10 and in the future TMT 18 and 20 tags, phosphorylation modifications, especially glycomics, which requires MS to AM, and of course different data independent acquisition, top-down analysis, whole proteome analysis, and so on. And this is the latest instrument, released a month ago, which is Orbitrap Lumos. So it has brighter atmosphere to vacuum interface, improved quadrupole, vacuum, improved ETD, and high scan rate Orbitrap and Hindrap. This is how a new interface looks like, so it's like a letterbox, so that it sucks all ions, but at the same time, ions are always close to the wall, so that they get solvated pretty well. And this is the source which could provide up to 50% transmission from solvent to the ion downstream. And this is just one of examples of ET-HCD as presented by Albert yesterday. So this is glycopeptide. This is what we get when we sequence it by HCD. This is by ETD. But now ET-HCD is a standard fragmentation method. And for this glycopeptide, it allows almost 100% coverage of the sequence. And this is why this technique is so important for PTMs and complicated analysis like this. And this is another important application, top-down of intact antibody, which was just reduced and then run by non-LCMS. And then you could get monoisotopic peak of light chain, heavy chain, and then they could be sequenced by all those techniques combined in real time, and then you get 91% sequence coverage for light chain and 63% coverage for glycosylated heavy chain. And this is done sort of for LCMS. And now we come to the final subject, which is a quantitation by mass spectrometry. So here you could see the first quantitation experiment in history, the weighing of human heart in ancient Egypt mythology. So the heart must be lighter than the feather. So this is like 5,000 years old technique. So we have advanced quite a lot since then, but nevertheless, the importance of quantitation is really clear from here, because after that, you either go to heaven or to hell. And this frequently what happens with the quantitation as well. So traditionally, we have these two instruments used for quantitation. So they have horrible all ion detection capabilities, but they have great transmission, they have great dynamic range, which is even more important. Even though mass accuracy for quadrupole is poor, dissolving power is so-so, but it's simple. And this sort of resulted in the current state of the art, that complexity of magnetic sector, in spite of its beautiful dynamic range and dissolving power and so on, forced them to move towards the marginal applications, and majority of quantitation is done by quadrupole analysis. And important is that they're both beam type, so they could process full ion current, up to 10 billion charges per second. And as you remember, all our alternatives, wide mass range analyzers, could detect only this one. So what should we do in order to use wide mass range analyzers for quantitation? We need intelligent sample dependent control of this analysis. Then we probably could use them for quantitation. So for example, for Orbitrap analyzer, you need to do the following, or for any trap analyzer, you need to reach each of those parameters for good quantitation. High linearity between input and output, high discriminated power, high dynamic range, very good limits of quantitation, compatibility with modern separations. And this is where we started with Orbitrap analyzer. And then automatic gain control by ion trap and then by other techniques allowed to control space charge effects, also mass accuracy. And then intelligent filling allowed to bypass, to utilize those 10 million ions really effectively using all these different techniques for quantitation. And from the beginning we had high transmission, high sensitivity, and then by parallelizing detection and injection of ions, we were able to combine these instruments with LC, and then fast detectors allowed to combine it with UHPLC. And so this is how we improved the instrument towards the status that it could be used for quantitation. And now we could compare different analyzers, how they could be used for quantitation, and where their strengths and weaknesses. So let's compare four instruments which all have the same front end. So they have quadrupole mass filter, followed by collision cell, and then they have different back ends. Either it is trapequad or coexactive, Kutov, or Kutov with the trapping device in front of the time of flight instrument. And we consider experiment when our precursor fragments into n channels of equal height, equal intensity. And then we try to quantify on the sum of fragment ion intensities. And we want to get CVs less than 10%. And then, if we submit, substitute here characteristics, parameters for each of those analyzers, 50% transmission for selected mass for quadrupole, at least 30% for orbitrap, 4% for orthogonal top, 10% for trapping top. Then, and we assume that there are no interferences for tripod, which is low resolution technique, then we will see that tripod is the best when we convert one precursor into one fragment. So you need only 200 ions from the source in order to get reasonable quantitation on the fragments. If you have two fragments of equal intensity, it's a little bit worse because you need to switch third quadrupole to first fragment and then to the second fragment. So it means that you need to spend two times more ions, more like 400 ions when you have two fragments, or 600 ions when you have three fragments, and so on and so forth. So the number of ions needed from the source for triple-quadrupole grows linearly with the number of channels. Of course, it is equal intensity of fragments. It's a simplified case, but this is showing the trend. For orbitrap, because we have image current detection, but we detect all fragments in parallel, we start from higher number of ions needed for one channel, 400. But then, because we detect all these fragments in parallel, the number of ions which we need grows only slowly with the number of channels. And the same for time of flight. So the number of ions which you need grows very slowly with the number of channels, but because of low transmission for orthogonal TOFs, you need a lot of ions. But tracking time of flights, like impact or modern SINAP instruments, they require much less ions to get the same quantification. And so this also shows why we believe that accurate mass analyzers could have a big advantage in the end for quantitation. That once you are above three or four fragments, you are not only more selective and could utilize all advantages of accurate mass and so on, but your absolute sensitivity is also higher than for trapped quadrupoles. And this is exactly the case for peptide quantitation. So this is why I would state that future of peptide quantum lies with the accurate mass analyzers on the back. For simple analyze, small molecules, pharmaceutical compounds where you stay somewhere here, there is no point to use accurate mass analyzers unless you are gaining also some additional selectivity and other parameters. But for peptide quantitation, for proteomics, this is where we are located. So this is where it's better to use accurate mass. And here you could see different technologies, how we could use accurate mass techniques for quantitation. And this actually depends on the sample. So if you have low complexity sample, which means low dynamic range or high quality of separation, and you are looking for high abundance peaks, then actually you will be really well off by just running full MS experiment. You don't have any isolation, you just run full MS spectra, and then you could quantify thousands of ions in parallel. Unfortunately, life is never kind. So at some point, as you always have in proteomics actually, you have a complex sample, or you have insufficient separation, or your analytes are spread over high dynamic range. And then all life becomes quite difficult because you still see all intense peaks, but all low level peaks are not really quantifiable anymore by full MS. So you need to somehow reduce load on your analyzer to filter away things which you could filter. And this is where you step down the width of your isolation. So instead of full mass range, you reduce it to, let's say, 10 or 20 AU. And this is where you run data independent acquisition or swap with wideband isolation. And this allows you to go deeper into complex mixtures, though, of course, low abundance species are not available to you because you don't have much time for each of the windows. So once you run out of quantitation capabilities of data independent and swap, this is where other techniques which are more targeted could help. For example, this so-called wide sieve window isolation with data independent, which is available on Fusion Tripod and Lumos. So this combines wideband isolation, for example, 180 mu for full MS with 240,000 resolution, followed by 3 mu or 4 mu isolation fragmentations in the linear trap for confirmation. This allows to push down detection limits, but the number of channels which you follow is lower than in SWOT. Then you come to the next level when you go even deeper into sample. So here you just follow several windows, several tens of windows per second, with the targeted isolation of narrow bandwidth. And this is so-called selected ion monitoring, where you use high resolution to fish out small species in the presence of large compounds nearby. And then when you run out of SIM, so that your little ions are hidden by large matrix peaks, then you apply MSMS. So you select this window, fragmented, even though you don't see any parents there. And then you look just after accurate mass of fragments, which you know upfront. And this allows you to go really deep to lowest abundance peaks, but you cannot get more than something like 10 such targeted MSMSs per second. So this is the entire space which we could cover by high resolution accurate mass analyzers for quantitation. And unfortunately, it depends on the sample. And so, of course, as usual, we have big elephants in the room of mass spectrometry. So if MS is so powerful, why it is not yet in every lab? And is there any space for newcomers to mass spectrometry? And if there is, why next generation sequencing is stealing hearts and funds from MS? And is the fate of mass spectrometry to be always displaced sooner or later by optical techniques as soon as MS starts to approach mass usage? So like this happened in sequencing. We only started to sequence DNAs by mass spectrometry, starting to publish a lot and so on in the 90s, and then fluorescence just wiped it all out because it provided millions of channels and huge multiplexing advantage as well as cost advantage and so on. And so these are elephants in which we have to work hard, otherwise we'll be in position with this guy here. And this is how I feel sometimes. And here I would like just to illustrate this by showing you, again, not really highly publicized death ladder of mass spectrometry. So this is where we started with, for example, our highest transmission instruments, Tripod Quads, about 15 years ago. So we already had nanospray. So we start in solution with our molecules. We convert them into ions. We lose a little bit. And then we lose two orders of magnitude. These are orders of magnitude of losses. We lose two orders of magnitude as we transfer ions from atmosphere into vacuum. Then, depending on how we run our quadrupole, if we select one channel, we lose another factor of three. If we have to switch between hundreds of channels or follow hundreds of compounds, we lose another three or four orders of magnitude. Then selection, then we lost another order on fragmentation, and then another three orders on jumping between different channels for detection. So since then, technology improved a lot at every point on the sources, on quadrupoles, and so on. So now we start in solution, convert a lot of molecules into ions if you use nanospray. We could transfer them into vacuum with very high transmission. And then if you have just one channel to follow, both for precursor and fragment, we could detect more than 10% of all molecules which we had originally in solution. But if we select one out of hundreds of those channels, and then we select just one out of tens or hundreds of fragments, then we are still losing like six orders of magnitude. So this is modern triple quadrupole, the nanospray with the selected reaction monitoring mode. So this is where modern high resolution accurate mass instruments give a big improvement, because they detect fragments in parallel. We lose only those four orders of magnitude of ions. Only every 10,000 ions is detected, or 100,000 ions on our detectors. But we want to be here, where triple quadrupole could be if there was only one precursor and one fragment. So we still have three orders of magnitude to go as our results. So somehow we need to defeat these losses on selection. So how could we do this? Actually, there is a lot of solutions on which people are working since beginning of zeros. So there is two-dimensional MSMS, time-aligned parallel fragmentation using ion mobility, DREAMS, synchronous precursor selection, like we have in fusion, and all of them are focused on selecting one precursor, but not throw away everything else, 99.9%, but keep them somewhere. And the idea is around for 15 years, but it's still not realized, because there are huge problems. It requires tracking over broad mass range, there is high space charge of modern ion sources, low resolution of selection, poor isolation windows. We also have charge state, chemistry kicking in, and so on. But this is where all hardcore mass spectrometers are still working on. And finally, in conclusion, I would like to emphasize that this is where we started many years ago with the mass spectrometry looking at biological samples. Not much detail, not much anything. And then ultra high resolution gave detail to this picture, and MSNS sensitivity gave color to those molecules. And now improved quantitation and throughput of modern mass spectrometers allows us to follow biological systems in dynamics. And of course, instrumentation continues to develop rapidly towards better usability and performance, especially for high resolution accurate mass. And for future, we expect that progress will be raising by throughput by orders of magnitude, improving quantitation, resolution, dynamic range, multiplexing analysis, increasing the quality of post-translation modification analysis, top-down and structural protein analysis. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I hope that you could go now for lunch.